Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Anomalous Realities. I am your host, Shaman Lenita Elder. And we had a guest planned for you this evening, but we don't have them in studio with us. So we do have Marky in studio with us tonight. Marky, how are you doing?
Hello. Annoyed that I missed the cue to play some music. God damn it.
That's all right.
Never mind. But good evening. Hello. Thank you. Yeah, doing pretty well. Sorry to hear your guest hasn't shown up yet, but hopefully Michael will.
Yes, yes. Well, yeah, our guest tonight, hopefully at some point, will be Michael Perlin. He is an author and a film director. He's done a very, very large film, actually, very popular film called Three Magic Words. So he's a director, writer, producer of Three Magic Words, which is a metaphysical film. It reveals the common theme that's taught to us by all the great spiritual masters. In 1992, his curiosity and interest in all things metaphysical led him to a book that provided many of the answers that he was looking for about human consciousness. Three Magic Words was the name of the book. It was by Yul Stanley Anderson. He's widely known as U.S. Anderson. And this was the key to his inspiration to create the film. Michael believes that the problems we face in the world today, war, poverty, prejudice, human injustice, are still going on because we live mostly on a religious planet and not on a spiritual one. He believes there's an answer, a solution, that can only come from a new universal spirituality that embraces a unifying reality of all religions and sets aside the old ego-driven idea that there is only one true way. And now, real quick, I'm going to bring Melina in with us. And she'll be joining us now. Melina, are you with us?
I am.
There she is. Hi.
Hello.
So how was your week?
It was good. It was very hectic. I had my daughter, Lilla, she graduated third in her class.
Congratulations to Lilla.
Yes. And so we had a busy week. And it was eventful.
They always are. And summertime always always kind of brings in all kinds of new activities. I know that people are so busy during the summertime. Everybody's on vacation. They're doing new things. Our guest tonight, as I understand it, is working on several films right now. So I'm sure that's why we haven't been able to reach him as yet, but hopefully he'll be here soon. We did originally have a different time scheduled for the interview because we used to be in a time slot 2 hours previous to this. So hopefully that didn't throw a monkey wrench in the works for him at all. But yeah, really hope not. So we've been talking about Michael Perlin. He is an author and a filmmaker, director, producer. And he has this film called Three Magic Words. The film had its big Hollywood premiere at the Harmony Gold Theater, and it sold out all 400 seats the day before the event. On December 21st, 2012, the big day, as it would be for most people who were into the whole 2012 thing, the film was brought to London for its European premiere. Soon after, the movie was picked up by a major distributor and released in over 100 million homes via various cable and TV and satellite services. So Three Magic Words continues to be purchased as a video on demand on Amazon. It can also be found on iTunes. It's one of those films that's kind of a tool of awakening for people on the planet. And it's also available in DVD format now. And it's also subtitled in many languages. And if I'm not mistaken, you can get a copy of it at the website or on Amazon. The website is 3magicwordsmovie.com, and that's 3 with the number 3 not spelled out. So now,
Yeah. Well, it says you can internationally watch it online.
But yes, you can. Yeah.
I don't know if that means you can in America, though.
Yep. Yep. Okay. It can be watched online. I think there's like different sites that that stream it, and there's like a little rental fee or something small.
So Three Magic Words is the film he's already produced.
Uh-huh.
And did you say he's got more in the works?
A lot more in the works. There's one called The Star King. And this one is supposed to be a film about a mysterious Egyptian pharaoh that suggests a connection between extraterrestrials and ancient Egypt during the 18th dynasty. This one, I guess, would kind of bring in a lot of elements of the ancient astronaut theory into the film itself, which would help present it to people in a more entertaining format than just, you know, watching cold hard facts. So, yeah. I think that'll be very interesting. I don't know when that one is due out, though.
Is that similar to the book that you showed me, Fantastic Adventures in Metaphysics? Are these related, like a film?
Well, the book, I think, is actually in and of itself. I'm not sure because I haven't been able to read the book yet. So I don't know exactly what is covered in the book.
Sure.
So... But-
The new his next film is Star King. So.
Yeah, The Star King. And then after that, there's Tesla, which is, of course, about the life of Nikola Tesla. So that one should be very, very interesting. I'm kind of curious, and this was something I wanted to talk to him about, you know, is if he has information that he uses and presents in the film that is different than what other people have as far as in regards to Tesla, or if it's just, you know, an attempt to reach people and spread, you know, what he's done and get it out there, because you won't find him in history books. A lot of people don't even know he exists. He's becoming more well known now, I think mostly because of the internet, but he's not mentioned in textbooks in the United States. I don't know about around the rest of the world. Do they teach about him at all in the UK?
I don't think so, but I agree that there needs to be maybe more information out there about Tesla, for example. So it wouldn't really matter which angle he took. It's going to be good information either way. But I don't think he's that. I've not heard of him, I'm afraid. But where do you suppose then the information came from for his earlier works? Where's the inspiration of that?
Well, a lot of his notes and things were confiscated by the government, and so they also stole a lot of his patents. The things like the free energy were stolen so that it would never be released, because obviously free energy is bad for big business, especially the oil industry. Things like that. There were lots of references to extraterrestrial information coming to him. And there were some say that there were journal entries and things that he said in interviews that suggested that he actually credited information given to him during dreams and other time periods to how he came up with his inventions. And he believed that he was given this information by beings that were not of this plane or this earth. So that's something that I don't think a lot of people actually knew about Nikola Tesla. And I'm sure it would probably be covered in the movie, I would imagine. I would hope.
Hopefully so. There's a lot of interesting things about him.
Definitely so. He has another movie called The Skeptic, and it's about you.
am I played by Adam Sandler or something?
You think that would be the best fit?
Well, some douchebag. Yeah, I know.
okay,
so it's the skeptic. Yeah,
it's about a young man who battles his own mind to discover the truth about UFOs, crop circles, government conspiracies, extraterrestrial gods, and world domination. Looks like the Illuminati is being brought into this one, which is interesting. I have been coming across a lot of information about the Illuminati lately that has been online. There has been a lot of people trying to expose the Illuminati and the control of the Illuminati. I came across so many different things. There was something that said that Vladimir Putin, the Russian president, had actually told his personal staff that he didn't like being in the same room as the Queen of England because she shapeshifted into a reptilian in front of him.
Vladimir Putin said that?
Yes. Yes. This is what I read. Now, this is allegedly, of course, because I read it. So, you know, I can't confirm it. But I guess apparently people in his staff has said that he told them that, which is beyond that. That's a whole different thing, depending on, you know, what you believe on whether that's actually Illuminati related or if that's just extraterrestrial related or interdimensional related. Because do we really know, you know, what the nature of reptilians is, honestly? Do we know that they're connected to the Illuminati? Do we know that they exist for sure? There is a lot of evidence to suggest that they do exist with ancient artifacts and things. But what is the nature of them? Are they from somewhere else? Are they from Earth? And they just came from a different genetic line than we do and, you know, have the ability to make themselves look like us? I don't know. That's one of those things that...
Well, that's often what you hear about is them having a utility belt that seems to project the hologram of them looking like a normal person.
It must fail sometimes because you've seen it. There's numerous videos, you know, where you see people morph and shift, you know, in front of the camera. Now, sometimes some of those videos, it definitely just looks like pixelation to me. But then again, other times... The way that it pixelates, the way that it looks like it does, doesn't really look like any distortions I've seen before, except for in these specific circumstances. And there's usually a shift to the eyes as well. So I don't know. But that's another fascinating topic that I would actually really, really love to cover in depth sometime. The whole, you know, reptilian thing and the bloodlines and whether or not, you know, it's actually connected to the Illuminati or the perceived Illuminati. I saw a lot of articles this week about the music industry, you know, and the Illuminati controlling the music industry, how it seems to be connected as far as very, very famous singers using the all-seeing eye. You know, they put the pyramid over one eye. Things like that to show that they're, you know, a part of it. Several of them have openly admitted that they've sold their soul to the devil or Lucifer, whatever they refer to it as. And for me, you all know I'm not a religious person, so I have to look at that objectively and think, okay, what are they saying here? You know, what are they trying to convey? Because I personally don't think that the things that people believe to be certain things are exactly what they think they are, if you can follow what I'm saying there. Demons, angels, things like this, I don't think they're as cut and clear as the descriptions that they're put in texts. And I think the nature of them is something that we don't fully understand. So it's not just as simple as saying this is an angel, this is a demon, and the nature of where they come from and what they're about. But it does seem that there are certain entities that are most definitely focused on pain and suffering and hurting people and making people miserable. And that seems to be almost like a lower vibrational thing. I don't know.
Well, you know, a lot of the angels, the angelic descriptions mm-hmm. are lizard-like, are reptilian-like.
Yeah.
For a lot of even the positive angels.
Isn't that... curious?
Yes.
Now, the Anunnaki are presented that way, so perhaps the Anunnaki never left.
Perhaps.
Because if you look at the depictions of the Anunnaki, they are reptilian in form in the old pictures. So perhaps the reptilians are simply the Anunnaki that have never really left the planet, although it was said that they did. Who's to say that, well, maybe they didn't come back? And who's to say that they're not the gods that, well, they were considered gods during their time period, but who's to say that they weren't, you know, the same beings that were worshipped later on as well? Hard to say.
Yes, but who's to say that this is actually the truth, or this is how it is, or that this is...
Well, it's all speculation. I mean,
it is all speculation. But
other than the evidences that are presented in artifacts.
But even the speculation that it's all predefined is I don't know.
What do you mean by predefined?
Well, like with aliens, yeah, you know, you go so far down the aliens line, and then you've got all this thing where there's apparently 16 species and we know X amount of them. And
oh, I don't believe that.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, I know the stuff you're talking about could be backed up in like ancient artifacts and things like that. But I still think it's, as you said, we need more, or I don't know. It doesn't
fully understand it. I know that, look, I accept. Okay, as much as I know, I do know that other beings exist that we don't understand. That much I know for certain. I've seen things. My children have seen things. I've actually had my children draw what they've seen separately without either one knowing that they shared what they had seen. They both drew something extremely similar. They had both seen grays, and when they drew, and I've got these pictures, actually, I could share them somewhere. I've still got copies. I scanned them in of their pictures, their drawings, and both of them drew what looks a lot like a gray with a very, very small mouth, non-existent almost nose with nostril holes. But the thing that was most key to me about these two drawings, and they were very young at the time when they drew them, is that in both the drawings, they drew their reflection in the eyes of the being. In both of the drawings, they both were able to see themselves reflected in the being's eyes. That's a little detail that, you know, it just struck me because, you know, we've seen pictures of extraterrestrials before. They might have seen a movie or something. Who knows? But this isn't what they were doing. They were telling me about something that they saw in front of them that frightened them, and they individually each drew for me these photos. And the fact that they both drew the reflection in the eyes really just struck me in a way that it disturbed me, honestly. So I've seen things, they've seen things, so I know things exist, but it's the nature of what they are. That's what's in question.
Sure,
we don't
definitely
know if they're from somewhere else. We don't know if they're from this planet on the same plane.
But Lenita, how do we know all of this is connected to all of us? To the point, what I mean is, how do we know that it's not an individual experience? Like,
that's possible. It's entirely possible.
That might be the things that make up your unexplained stuff, but it could be completely different from one person to the next. Why does one person to the next never see the same Bigfoot or blah, blah, blah?
Well, they see similar, but you're right. There are discrepancies. The weird thing is, though, is that when you look back through the ages, even though people have individual experiences, they have similar experiences. And this goes back to cave-dwelling times. There are drawings of beings like these beings on cave walls. So it's like people individually, you know, had these random experiences, but they're having experiences with the same type of entity, with the same species of entities, or similar species, I don't know. But they're definitely having experiences that are similar. Another example of a very unexplainable shared experience, I guess you could say, are the ayahuasca experiences that people have. People individually have these experiences where they see very similar or the same things. Now, if you're going on a some sort of a hallucinogenic trip, right, if what you're seeing isn't real, then it's going to be a basis on what your individual mind is going to come up with, right? So the experience is going to be based on you. But the weird thing is that a lot of times these experiences are similar. People see the same types of things. And it isn't just ayahuasca. Graham Hancock talked a great deal about these experiences that people have in his book Supernatural. And in it, he talks about people on various, I think LSD was one of them. It was either LSD or pure DMT. But in both of them, these people, lots and lots of people across studies, have these experiences with these small gnome-like beings that would take them to like these mechanical clockwork places. And from this place, it would take them wherever they chose to go.
They call them machine elves.
Yes, right. Exactly. Yes, machine elves. And so here's the thing. If we're having individual experiences that aren't real, if this isn't something real they're experiencing and it's an individualized hallucination, why are people hallucinating the same thing all across the world, different time frames, different people, different places that are not connected? Why are they having the same hallucination? It's very, very strange. So in that experience, even if you were to say it's just a dream, why would people dream the same things? That's the kind of point I'm getting to, is that there's something real that's connecting in all of these things. So what we need to find out is what the nature of these things are. I don't know if we'll ever do it, but I think we're coming closer to do it with all of the research that's been done, you know, with string theory, subatomic physics. All kinds of different things have been found that show that things are connected. Like we were talking about the particles, Marky, last week.
Yep.
Yeah, things like that. We're finding out things, new things, that we couldn't even possibly imagine could be real years and years ago. Now we're finding out these things are real. And some of these new discoveries that we're finding out could start to explain the answers behind these strange realities that people are having. It might explain things that used to be paranormal may now become explainable in a way that we can get it. It won't take away from what it is, but it will help us understand it better. And that's what I'm hoping we're going to get with the new research that we are going into, what scientists are working on right now, is a greater understanding of things that we currently don't understand. Because isn't that what science is all about?
It certainly is.
Yep.
No, you're right. I stand corrected. Shared experiences and things like that. Yes, okay, there is evidence and I just believe in that. You're right. So ultimately, yeah, I need to rethink that.
There's weird things out there. We just got to figure out. We just need to understand them better so that they're not weird.
Is science really asking the right questions for that kind of thing?
Science has limited itself, don't you think, a little bit? Because they've kind of become, some of them have a very closed-minded way of looking at things. They kind of limit it because they don't want to go down certain paths. That was actually one of Nikola Tesla's most well-known quotes, was that the day that science begins to investigate the unexplained, the mysteries, the mysterious, they will make more advances in one decade than they have in the last several hundred years or something to that effect. That was basically what he was saying, was that when we start to look at things that are the unknown, when we start to investigate that, we're going to learn so much in a short period of time compared to what we've learned in a huge span of time. And so I think we're starting to come to that point now. I really do.
Definitely. But will it be mainstream science? Because that's when people take notice. No one. See, there was an article that Nugget, you remember her, put up on Facebook the other day.
Yes, Nugget.
I don't know if you saw that article about two mathematicians. You know, they said mathematically, there are alien probes already around our solar system and whatnot, because mathematically it just has to be that way. And so, but this is two people, therefore it's not mainstream science, therefore it's just a Facebook article.
And no.
We never reached the next stage. We're still at square one.
But some of these fields of research, even though I don't know if you would call it mainstream, but some of the current areas of physics is by just default starting to go down that path because they really can't avoid it if they want to go forward. So they may not have a choice. they may do it without even intending to do it, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, that's a good point.
It's kind of coming to one of those points where we're starting to understand things, that they're starting to bring things together, kind of group them up, like the fact that light can be, you know, a wave, a particle at the same time, things like that. I mean, it starts to call into question, because it's when it's observed that it takes on a certain form, which in and of itself is one of those things that starts to prove that the idea of the law of attraction has merit in it. Current things in physics that have been coming forward lately show that, like is drawn to like. So if you focus your brain on a certain thing, it brings more of that to you somehow.
Well,
that's very strange.
That touches on the point that I was going to make earlier, but decided not to.
Go ahead.
Yeah, like the law of attraction and that sort of thing. That's the love angle. I mean, do you really expect science to... I know they do in some instances, but like proper science doesn't look into things like that, really.
Well, I don't think they mean to. I think it's just happening because it's connected, and it's not their intention, but it's going to happen. I think that's how these things are going to
end up
coming into light.
Yeah, well, I think like things like the law of attraction, they're positive and they're good things, but it is one of those things that's just found in 100 random books and not in like a single textbook anywhere. You know what I mean? It's like it's...
Oh, of course. Do you know why that is?
I believe you're right about... No, go ahead.
Because...
I can probably take a guess.
You want to take a guess? And then go ahead.
I was just going to finish, as I was saying, it's fringe science.
No.
Don't get me wrong. I think it is possibly there, but it's... Yeah. No, go ahead.
The reason, though. The reason is because when a person understands that, and this is one of those things that's been guarded for ages by secret societies, because you understand that ability to manifest, and when you fully know how to actually use it and harness it, what you can do is not very limited by a whole lot of things other than the massive focus of others around you. This is why there's so many things in play, like the negativity in the media and stuff. It is controlled and it is kept this way because those that are in positions of power have gotten there because they know how to manifest it. But they don't want everybody to be able to manifest what they want, because if that happened, then how can they stand on top and how can they have everything? How can they have the world the way they want it? So they try to keep that information from the people, and they try to poo-poo it and make everybody think that it's nonsense, and make people be ashamed of believing in it, and make people doubt it and say it's not possible. But here's one of the things I've always said. The reason that prayer works is because they're allowing it to be used, but in a way that you don't give yourself credit for creating what's coming into your life. Okay, that way the positive things that come from your quote-unquote prayer, you believe are coming to you from an external source that's doing something nice for you. Okay, what's actually happening is you are raising up your vibration to a state, and you are requesting to have something brought to you. You're focusing your energies on that, and the law of attraction is bringing it back to you. So it's helping manifest that to you. There are a couple of reasons why it won't manifest very well. One would be if you doubt yourself, and in the back of your mind, you're like, but it's not going to work. It's not going to happen. Because then you're putting that out there instead. Another reason it would be is because there are other people out there that are focusing negatively against whatever you're trying to put out there. Because it's a balance of wills and energy. Although if you were to take a page from our should be guest tonight's book, you would understand that everyone, we're all connected and we're all each other. So I'm you and you're me. So I'm literally talking to myself right now. And every listener out there is me in the same, in the sense that we are all a part of the same energy, the same creative force that makes everything in the universe that we understand it work.
You're listening to me, Lanita Elder, on A Novel of Realities. that's cool. That's cool.
It's one of those concepts that's really hard for people to take in. Even myself, it is, because this thing that we call the ego that we have that makes us think that this self thing that we're in is real, but we're actually part of a greater being or entity or creation or consciousness or energy. Split up into many different things, having many different experiences at once. So we're part of a collective consciousness, according to theory. Theory.
It is theory, but you kind of touch on what happens to form a reaction to make me a bit of a skeptic along the way. It's like you say the universe or in prayer to whoever that connection might be to, can deliver like positive things, and I totally believe that.
That's the thing, you're not praying to anything other than yourself in truth, because you're a part of that consciousness. It's not like it's something that's inhabiting you.
Yeah, but Lanita, it will deliver. Yeah, I'm not disagreeing with that. What I'm disagreeing with is why then does all this positive energy, and you know, things like the love and these just really big things that are clearly the most positive and the most influential, and they have the most answers or actions, reactions to actions. I don't know how you describe it. Why then, after all of that, has that led to maybe other civilizations out there becoming weird, I don't know, you know, reptilians and stuff? And how has it led to evil demons that you see? Through all this stuff that we're trying to learn, this positive activity we're trying to learn.
But we're not just trying to learn positive. The thing. I mean, there has to be a balance in all things, or nothing could exist. There has to be a balance. And I know Wingman would disagree with me until the end of time, saying that evil is not necessary, but everything is necessary. Yeah. There has to be a balance between light and dark, good and evil, happiness and sorrow. These things have to both exist for one to exist. Neither one can exist without the other. It's a duality. That's the nature of the universe that we live in.
Why is that? Maybe that's
I'm not sure. I don't think that all universes are like that. I really don't. I think that there are some universes that are whole. They are universes of wholeness that don't require duality. But our universe, and perhaps it's just an experience that we've chosen to have because we want to have all that there is to experience, requires duality. It has to have happiness in order to understand what sorrow is, or vice versa. It has to experience pain to know what the feeling of love and comfort is. Otherwise, you wouldn't know that it was anything if that's all that existed. Does that make sense? Kind of?
Yeah, it's a nice way to look at it as well.
I mean, if light was always around and there was no darkness, how would you know that light was actually light?
You
would have no contrary.
Exactly. Yeah, totally. Yeah, no, like you say, you can't be sad without being happy first, or vice versa.
Right.
And it's just, these things don't really...
And that's the yin and the yang, you know, that is, you know, part of Asian culture that they have. And that's kind of what's meant by it. This is my personal symbol, that symbol that I use for Anomalous Realities. That's the basis of it. I've got the sacred feminine, the sacred masculine, and then the I in it is the inner sight, inner wisdom. And then the yin yang in it is the balance within all of that. So it's in knowing through understanding the balance. A person can't be all good. You have to have some darkness within you. It's just, I mean, I love not to, but I have some darkness in me too. It's just the way it is. Everyone has some. We will try to balance our light to be greater, to tip our scales so that our light is greater. But none of us are perfect. That's one of those things that even, you know, even the Bible will teach, is that no person is perfect. No man is perfect. That's just the way it is. That's one part of, you know, Christianity that I definitely agree with, is that there's just no such thing as a perfect human being. Not in the way you would try to vision a person that just never does anything that's, you know, not wrong or harmful in some way.
Yeah, no, I think you're absolutely right. You have to take the bad with the good for both of them to work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, I say I'm not religious, but that doesn't mean that I think that religions aren't important at all, because I know that there is a definite purpose for religions. For some people, it helps them set up the categories in their life and help them have a way to, like, a roadmap to trying to be a better person, you know, to help them try to live their life in the way that they want to see fit. And it helps them feel like they have purpose. It gives people comfort in understanding and not fearing death, because they believe that there is a heaven or a hell. Hell is obviously the consequences of having a very negative balance in your life, right? Heaven would be, you know, your reward for doing more positive things. So I think it's a way to help people not be as harmful towards others. But it's also been used as a way to control people, because it's been pretty much rule since the beginning of time that people in power don't really care about hurting people. They don't really care what they have to do to become, I guess, wealthy and have power over other people. It doesn't really matter. They don't care.
Well, clearly that seems to happen in anything where, you know, where leadership and power elements start to come in. That's where it all breaks down, really.
I think that's where the phrase money is the root of all evil came in, because money equals power. It equals wealth. It equals so many things in our society.
A lot of religions have a lot of money at the center of them as well. So that's an unavoidable fact.
There is a corruption through money.
I don't really need a poke on my ass about this one, but yeah, there's probably a darker side to the financials there.
I'm very impressed with the new Pope. I have to say, I mean, for you know, a non-religious person, I'm very impressed with the new Pope. He has a very good heart, a very good spiritual nature, and he's a person that I would definitely be happy to know, because he cares about humanity. He's stood up and, you know, basically stood behind knowing that certain things have to be changed and righting wrongs that have been done. But yeah, he's a decent person. Yeah. I would openly say I'm very impressed with the new Pope.
He seems quite open and down to earth. But
he definitely does. Yeah. If he is all that he seems, he is definitely a person that I would consider one of the ascended masters, as they refer to it. A person who is achieved enlightenment and live their life in service to humanity, trying to make it a little bit better.
Exactly. But then, yeah, I would say the same thing about President Obama. And I'm sure someone listening
really
wouldn't think that. but that kind of thing, yeah, it's the thing with that is it, that doesn't necessarily mean all the bad stuff goes away just because.
Right.
Pope, bloke person.
But I'm curious on
Pope.
What aspects of the current president that you see that in.
Oh yeah, it would not be
when
it
he
would
passed
not, it would,
the
no, it
NDAA
would not,
that
it would
didn't
not, it would not be the same way you do it. It would not be because of the things you experience and feel and live by day to day. No, not at all. This is purely the same way you feel about the Pope. You don't know him really as a person. You have
right.
an idea of some of his actions. That it's the same.
Okay, but I'm curious now. You've got to share some of the things that, you know, give you that feeling.
He can string coherent sentences together. That's an
that's a good
admirable
start.
that gets instant reputation point for me.
There you go.
And like I say, but that's a purely cosmetic thing that makes me respect him.
Okay.
I'm sure he's done some terrible things that have not really helped you guys out. But well, he just seemed like you said about the Pope. He just seems like someone who does want to get to the heart of matters.
He was very inspirational, especially when he ran the first time. I actually voted for him the first time. I didn't the second time because of things that he did the first time. But
well, that's it. But there, I don't know too much about that because he's still a strong figure in my eyes. I
mean, okay.
Always keep up on his. I know I'm not like obsessed, but you know, like when you have your tragedies of gun mm-hmm. stuff, like gun shootings and that, is, you know, he seems to be genuinely concerned about those things, which is not a quality
that you see.
It is often seen in yes. levels of power and even presidents and prime ministers and stuff. So you look for that human element, but at the same time, as I say, that doesn't just erase everything else that might be stinky.
But now he's at the end of his term. We don't step in the political foray very often, okay? I got pulled in earlier this week. I joined Noreen during the round table, her Wild at Heart round table. It was late Monday night, early Tuesday morning. And I had all sorts of opinions thrown at me, mostly pro-Trump. And so now I'm curious as to, you know, from an outsider's perspective of what you know of the people running, what are your thoughts, Marky?
Well, again, this is my first thought is, oh, is this what you had as your electorate, as the people running mm-hmm. for president this
yeah.
time?
Okay.
Well done, America. Thank you for that. But now we're getting down to the crunch. I mean, I look into it a little bit. You know, Hillary Clinton is probably going to be your next president, is my view, I guess.
Mm.
I have no interest in Trump. Sorry, just doesn't even go on my radar, really. He'll make America something again, maybe, but maybe not what America was when it was great, is my view. Hillary Clinton, well, hasn't Hillary Clinton been in like the news since I've been like a child? But then Donald Trump has been, you know, he's mentioned in films from like 1992 mm-hmm. and that is like, oh my God. So these are big figures, icons in American society, history, I guess. I mean, even I can respect that to a degree, but neither of them stand out to me as true leaders, let's say. But don't know. Doesn't matter to me.
You know what freaks me out about Trump is that, and this is to do with, you know, something very unrelated in certain aspects, but if you've noticed, the program show The Simpsons has always been scarily predictive of future events. The Twin Towers getting destroyed, you know, that show covered it a long time beforehand. Prince being assassinated by the Illuminati was covered on that show. Years ago, many, many years ago, they had an episode where these music industry bigwigs came to Homer and said, "We can't control Prince. We want you to kill him." And they gave him money. He's like, "Okay, I'll kill him." And he kills Prince. So you see all of these things happening. Well, there was an episode of The Simpsons. And here's what's really scary is that there's an episode of Trump running for president. And there's a kid standing on the balcony as he's going down an escalator in a mall, and it drops a sign, and he drops a sign in the thing. And the exact same scene was played out on a real video of Trump and some of his people going down an escalator in a mall, and there was a child that dropped a sign just as he was going by, exactly like it happened on the series.
Eerie.
It's freaking me out, man. It's freaking me out. And and in other Trump news, mutual
not going into politics
friend,
or anything.
Musician Robbie Williams, his wife Ida is in this new show. What is it called? Monkeys, something monkeys. I'll have to look this up real quick. But she's on this new British political kind of it's kind of like a Saturday Night Live for Britain, right? And she's playing a Pope, a Trump zealot on this show. And so, and Rob tweeted, because he was proud of her to be on the show, "Go Trump," as a hashtag on his Twitter, and people lost their minds thinking that he supported Trump. It was so horrible. And he's like, if they don't know me by now, he didn't even try to defend himself. He didn't. He just let them go on and basically berate him for his little hashtag thing, which was really just a quote from her character on that show. Right? So,
Power Monkeys, that's
what it's called. Have you seen it yet, Mark? Power Monkeys?
Power Monkeys. I think I've heard of it, but I that involves watching a television, which is
It's on Channel 4 apparently, but it's called Power Monkeys, and yeah, she's on the show, and boy, he took a lot of flack over that.
He got Twitterversed, and isn't Twitter an anomalous reality in itself?
It really is. Yes, but you know, I like the Twitterverse. I mean, a lot goes on in the Twitterverse, and
it does.
Yeah.
And it seems to be quite a lot of proactive stuff as well, which is good. But it's poor Mr. Williams.
You can do a lot on Twitter. We had a movement on Twitter in the Native community not long ago that was hashtag No, I won't just move on, because we keep hearing that over and over again. People who aren't Native always saying, you know, if we're upset because of a team using us as a mascot, you know, calling themselves the Redskins or one thing or another, and they're like, why don't you just move on? And so a lot of Natives came together on Twitter and gave reasons why they wouldn't just move on. And I shared some personal ones, some very, very personal ones that were painful to me. But we have very good reasons for not just moving on. You know, things aren't, the Native community still isn't treated very well by the country at large. Honestly, we're not. We're still treated like mascots, and we're still treated very poorly often by law enforcement, especially in the Southwest areas. A lot of the areas where we have reservations and stuff, the local authorities can be very abusive to Natives and things. So, yeah, there's still a lot going on. So I think Twitter has its place in helping things that need to be helping create, I guess, awareness for certain issues that need to have, you know, people addressing them or being aware of them. So, yeah. Now, we got a little bit of time still before we have our break. Melina, I'm curious on who you're even thinking about supporting during this election.
I think she might have just gone to use the phone.
Oh, no. Did we lose her for a minute?
But she's just gone to... Yeah, okay. Someone's just given her a ring. But I was going to ask, wasn't one of the campaigners for president quite sort of pro-Native people or something like that? One of them was... Does that ring a bell?
No.
Okay. I thought you said someone had, or some had read somewhere where they were sort of definitely looking to make sure like there was no land issues and stuff like that.
We don't really have anybody that's really representing us like that right now. Even the candidate that I'm looking at right now, which is a libertarian, and I'm not even for sure about him, but when it's the choice of Hillary or Trump, I have to take another choice. I've got to go another direction because I can't put myself behind either one of them.
Fair enough. That's cool, man.
And there's no one candidate that I can say that I agree with on every point. There just isn't. But
what do you feel is the wider consensus, though? I mean,
the Libertarian Party right now is where I'm steering towards, and Gary Johnson is the headlining candidate right now. So I've put there's some issues of his that I don't necessarily agree with, but of all of the candidates, he's the one I dislike the least, I guess is the way to put it.
Is it, have you found this has become like a heated sort of topic between friends and things and just people you meet, or is it just under the rug?
It's more under the rug. I don't usually talk politics very often because in my experience, when it comes to politics, people are pretty set in their ways. I mean, people are conservative or they're liberal or they're, you know, one way or the other. And the thing is once people get a thought set in their head, there's not a lot you can do to sway it. I mean, you can try to show them examples of why something is bad or try to explain to them, you know, maybe to look from another perspective. But in my experience, when it comes to politics, people's brains just like shut down. So, you know, it's possible that happens to me, too, because somebody, you know, a couple of guys tried to convince me to go pro-Trump during the roundtable, and that wasn't happening. And I understood what they were trying to say, but I couldn't agree with them. That there's just way, way too many things. I really am kind of the opposite of pretty much everything he stands for. And he's flip-flopped on every single issue. Just about. Wow. So, I mean, he was a Democrat before and now he's a Republican. I mean, how big of a flip-flop can you get other than that? I mean, it's just crazy. It's like there are people that believe that he was put there because they didn't think Hillary stood a chance against the other Republican candidates. So they said, let's push Trump in there so that we make sure Hillary wins.
Like a plan, a political plan.
Yes, because if you look back at old video footage, they are very good friends. They've always talked very well of each other. Trump and the Clintons are like this, you know, fingers right now.
It's all a big club at the top, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Of any institution, it's all a big club, really.
Yeah. So
it's all part of the show, I guess. But
yeah, you know, I would be happy to bring a candidate on here, but you know how hard it would be able to get a candidate. I would even let Trump come on and try to plead his case if he wanted to.
Definitely.
But I don't think he'd come on.
Oh, Melina can share her thoughts.
There we go. We got a couple of minutes left. Let us know who you're thinking about.
Trump is ridiculous. And that's putting it nicely.
I know.
And, you know, Clinton, I think, is going to get it. And, you know, I really like how Bill Clinton did economically-wise as the president. So I'm really hoping that she brings some of those talents and skills back into the office with her. And her husband brings them with him.
Yeah.
And because at least then, you know, we can look for an improvement on the economy.
You think so? I mean, she's in bed with the Rothschilds. I don't know how that can be good for the economy.
Well,
I mean, she's close friends with them. There's lots of pictures of her walking with him, talking with him.
Yeah,
owns the world. That man owns the world. It's no wonder that she's so far ahead right now. Mm-hmm. I don't know. That's why, like I said, I'm not voting for them. I'm voting for the little guy. Cause
there's no good choices, you know. And it looks like Sanders is...
But I think, here's the thing. Because Bernie Sanders had so many supporters. And here's the thing. If you go, there's a website, and I'll find it if I can before the end of the show, maybe if somebody else takes a topic at some point. Gary Johnson had mentioned that there is a website you can go to that... You put in what your political views are and it will basically, it questions you, you know, what you support, this, this, and that. And it will pair you with a candidate that is closest to what you, you know, what you are agreeing with. And what he found was that his platform is closest resembles Bernie Sanders. So if they don't want to be voting for Hillary, they can transfer their votes over to Johnson. He's already got 11% of the vote before it was, you know, down to just Trump or Hillary. So now that it's down to that, people that thought that they might be able to get Sanders in there can put their Trump behind him. And we'll talk some more about different topics when we come back from the break. You are listening to Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio.
Hi there. I'm Professor Stephanie Hawking. I work in astrophysics, for Wayland Industries. But enough about me, because now, it's Anomalous Realities on freedomslips.com.
Welcome back, everyone. We are in hour two on Anomalous Realities. And just real quick, I would like to mention that we are a user-supported, listener-supported station. And without you, you would hear nothing but silence when you tune into our network and our radio show. So, you know, any donations you guys want to give, you go to the homepage, freedomslips.com, and click on the donation button. Donate $5, donate whatever, you know, you have that you can. If you enjoy what we do and you enjoy listening to quality radio here on Revolution Radio, give a little bit to help out the station. And now, also, I'd like to let everybody know that if you've missed episodes in the past, we now have our past episodes available up on YouTube. There is a YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/C/AnomalousRealitiesRadio. And that will take you to our YouTube channel. And it has archives of all of our past episodes, with the exception of Barbara Lamb. Unfortunately, she was having technical difficulties with her audio, and it was not loud enough to be picked up by the recording devices for the station, so we do not have an archive for her, but I have invited her to come back, and she could do a call-in in another way, and so hopefully those that didn't get to hear her the first time will be able to enjoy her episode when we have her back. Also, if you enjoy the show and you'd like to keep it going, there is also a support button on the YouTube channel. So, as always, welcome. Trust. So now we're going to our new hour, and we're done with politics. I think we've all had enough of politics, and it's something I really don't usually cover on the show at all. So we're going into some stories that I've come across that involve cryptozoology. The first story is about Ohio's Silver Creek Dogmen investigating a frightening encounter with Midwestern werewolves. And this was found on weekinweird.com. Okay, I couldn't read that right. All right, so this starts out with an interesting quote. It says, "I don't care if you believe me or not," was the serious, straightforward introduction I was given to a possible wolf sighting in the autumn of 2013. It was at this point that my longtime friend Andrew told me of not just one encounter, but two separate encounters with more than one strange bipedal creature out hunting game near Norton, Ohio. So, Andrew normally walks home. He has night shifts, which means he travels on quiet, dark roads. So that's an everyday occurrence for him. But one cold night in particular, while traveling down, I guess the road is called Johnson Road, which borders Silver Creek Metro Park, what he saw was anything but routine. Approximately 50 yards from the intersection with Medina Line Road, he stopped his car when two deer raced across the road heading south. But what caught his attention was what they were running from. Now here's a quote. "I would place them somewhere between 6'6 and 7 feet tall. They chased the two deer, which were both smaller, by the way, out across the street and into the woods. They ran, in formation, one in front and two behind, kind of next to each other. They were roughly 30 to 40 yards behind the deer. They were bipedal, very muscular, and fast, lightning fast. It all happened in just a few seconds. I couldn't describe any feature. Unfortunately, I'm assuming it was either a new moon or cloudy because it was very, very dark. But there were definitely a dark color, maybe a chocolate brown or black color." Okay, so the person pressed him for more details. There had actually been apparently Bigfoot sightings in Ohio as well. And another quote says, "They say that Bigfoot has long arms that swing when it runs. And it runs like a human. Whatever these were, they weren't Bigfoot. I can't describe how they moved, but they didn't move like a person." Less than a month later, Andrew was heading home on Johnson Road as he passed a moonlit cornfield and something ran in front of his car. It sounds like this is basically the same area. So whatever this is probably a regular in this area. So that in and of itself is somewhat disturbing. So we're going back to another quote from his story. The fields had full-grown corn stalks, but I don't know exact heights, only that the corn stalks were taller than me by a head, and I'm about 6 feet tall. This time, my sighting of two creatures was a quick flash because there was no open land to it. They basically leapt across the road as they broke the corn and landed about 10 to 15 feet into the field on the other side and kept running. This time, the pair that I saw in the moonlight, the first was black and the second was black with white or silver on its chest and back. Since the first three I saw were all solid color, that means there must be at least four different creatures. On October 11th in 2014, this person set out with his friend Andrew and his wife to see what they could find in way of evidence that might be still around. The location of the first sighting is bordered to the south by the Silver Creek Metro Park on the other side of the road, and there are three or four houses with a large field behind them. As Andrew pointed out, the creatures passed through the field and passed the houses on the night he saw them, meaning the creatures must not have much fear of the human habitation there. The second sighting was on the slight hill between the two large fields and the rather remote area. Not only were both places quite close to each other, they are also close proximity to Silver Creek. We planned an investigation of Silver Creek Metro Park, arriving at dusk. But the reservoir lake and surrounding park was alive with bonfires and hundreds of people celebrating the second annual fall family outing, making any chance of searching for wolfman-like creatures much too difficult. A follow-up trip is still slated for hopefully this winter, so they apparently hadn't done it yet at the time of this writing. Other witnesses may exist, but their reluctance to go public is understandable. So then this is a request to them that if anyone else has seen a large, dark creature running on 2 feet, you might think people would call you crazy, but they're asking that people report it. And then they talk about Linda Godfrey's book, which I would really like to get Linda Godfrey on the show. It sounds like she does a lot of research in this field. And she can put you in contact with them. Their son, Drew, was a witness to a large, dark creature over 6 feet tall lurking in the tree line in March. And this is his testimony. The lone rooster began to squawk, and a creature let out a fierce growl. Then all went silent. Drew heard what sounded like something jumping back over the fence, and the rooster squealed as if in pain. At that point, Drew grabbed a gun and flashlight and ran outside, searching the fence from the front porch with his light. He saw the rooster, but it disappeared, but it appeared to have something dark over its middle. It slowly dawned on Drew that the something dark was the muzzle of a creature with two glaring eyes. "Whatever it was," he said, "it seemed to look right through me. It turned my blood cold, and I was paralyzed with fear. I'm a hunter. I'm used to being in the wilderness and encountering big animals. Those animals don't scare me like this thing did. When I encountered this thing for the first time, I got a feeling that it wanted to hurt me. After researching something I never believed in, I'm convinced that this thing is a dogman." So apparently dogman is something that's a new thing. Apparently it's common in Ohio. Now, Melina...
But it sounds like a werewolf.
It does, doesn't it? I would love to have you share your experiences real quick for those who weren't listening on any previous episode when you mention them.
Oh, well, I saw something very similar to what would be considered a dog man or mm-hmm. a werewolf. And I was at my cousin's up in Alpena, Michigan, and they had pine forests there, and they had endless pine forests that go in rows. And it was a full moon night. It just happened to be, and it was clear out, so you could see for quite a distance away. And we were out playing in the pine forest, you know, and running and playing hide and seek. And we are all together in a group, and we look up, and that's when we saw this dog man. It had a distinct, it didn't look like Bigfoot. It had a distinct canine look to it, you know.
Scary.
And it was hunched over to where it was like almost like it was going to run on all fours, but it was kind of poised looking at us, and of course we got scared and we started screaming, and with me and I believe that there were my three other cousins with us, four, we started howling running through the woods going home. So it didn't pursue us or anything, you know.
Maybe it thought you were one of its own.
I don't know.
Was that the hope?
Yeah. But it looked at us, and it made the hairs on the back of my neck stand up.
Yeah, I could imagine. I can imagine. Oh, goodness. I've had a experience with a creature before, but it wasn't a werewolf type creature. Actually, I've had a couple of crypto type experiences. This thing was kind of like a Bigfoot, but not. And this has been kind of one of those very intensive, speculative conversations that I've gone through before, because this thing was, I don't know, I've never heard of anything like it before. We were, I was with my mother-in-law and my son, who was probably 10 at the time. And I was going into town at the store. And at the time, we lived kind of out in the country, and there was a big field across from our house that we would, you know, a road that we would have to drive on. The field would be on the left as we went, you know, towards town. So we came out of our driveway and we went to where the field was on the left. And I look to the side as I'm driving and I see something like above. It was flying right through the air, probably about 10 feet, I would guess, up above the field itself. And it was moving through the air like you would imagine an otter would swim in water, kind of like a dolphin, almost like movement, you know, up and down, wavy like. And it kind of almost looked like it was a furry creature, like a big beaver or an otter, but it was flying, right? And it was kind of like an orangish brown color. So I see this thing flying next to us. I'm like, what on earth is that? And we all see it, and it's right with us all the way up till we get to the stop sign. And then we're going to have to turn left. Well, it goes straight as it's on our left side, straight across the road that we're about to go onto. And it ends up going over towards a house. And it goes over to that house. Well, we turn left, and it's on our right side. As it comes across the road and it gets to the driveway of that house, this thing that looks like it's like a flying otter or something in the air changes shape and drops into a humanoid form. So now it looks like a very large human-shaped person. I couldn't make out a lot of details. It didn't look like a man because it still had that kind of furry look to it. But it went pretty fast, like huge strides, right next to their house. And there was a garage right there, and it went in between. And as we drove by, because I kept looking to see if I could find it, it was gone by the time we got by where it was. I couldn't find it anywhere. I couldn't see it anywhere. I don't know where it went. Maybe it lived there. Who knows? But it looked like kind of like a Bigfoot when it got to their yard. But before that, it looked like a freaking otter, like if an otter flew or swimmed in air. I don't know. Uh-huh. Hard to describe.
Bizarre.
Very, very bizarre. Yes. And that was one of the things I shared it on ATS almost immediately after it happened. That's abovetopsecret.com for people who don't know the acronym ATS. And here's the thing. I don't know what to make of it because I've never heard of a Bigfoot creature, you know, doing that before. But this definitely seems, and I think I talked to someone about this not too long ago, that perhaps some sort of a shapeshifter. That's the only thing I can think of, is something that changes shape. And I know that there had been, there's been lots of theories that Bigfoot are extraterrestrial creatures, that they're not actually from Earth, and that's why it's hard to find them. And that's why sightings are few and far between, which lends a little bit of credence, because this is also on ATS, but there were UFO sightings near that time frame too. And I actually did a podcast about the Mother's Day sighting. That's still on ATS somewhere. I'll probably get a link to that on our website. The website for the show is anomalousrealities.com. So if I end up putting things up on the website, now you know where to go. It's anomalousrealities.com. If you go there, it also has a list of our guests that are past and future. So you know, it's got a link to the archives. It's got a link to our social pages, Facebook and Twitter. Yeah, you guys, if there's any information that we cover on the show and I put up links later, that's where it's going, is anomalousrealities.com. And now back to the strange and unusual cryptid creatures talk. I'm going to let you go with another one now, because you had one that was not a werewolf thing, but more like a little fairy type creature or something. Melina.
Yes. Oh, I have had a couple. Well, my husband had a sighting.
Really? Go ahead. Yes. Go ahead and, if he's okay with you sharing it.
Oh yeah, he is. Well, at the time I was messing around with the fairy oracle, which brings a lot of fairy energy into your reality.
Is that the Doreen? Is that the Doreen Virtue one?
Yes.
Okay. Do you like that one?
I do. I like it.
Okay, because I've been thinking about getting that one. So, yeah.
So I was using that, and we had a lot of this energy. And my husband was playing a video game. He had just sat down to play a video game, and he was kind of zoning. You know how you zone out when you play a video game, and he's in the corner of. Well, at the time, my daughter was just an infant, and you know how you have those mobiles that you put on the floor and then you lay the baby down and they can play with the mirror and the little rattle that is attached to the side, and you know, it has a whole bunch of little trinkets and things dangling. Well, on one side of this toy was a mirror. It had like that silver coating mirror where you kind of, you're a little distorted when you look at it, but it's for babies. So he said out of the corner of his eye, he could see a little man, a little figure of a little person. He said it looked like a little man preening at itself in the mirror, looking at itself in the mirror. And he said, as soon as he moved his eyes to look at it, it was like a shadow, and it shot across the corner into the hall and disappeared. Wow. But he said he could see it from the corner of his eye, and he was playing his game and looking at it from the corner of his eye. But as soon as he went to look at it, boom, it was gone.
Just like a shadow person.
And then there was another time... my daughter, she woke up with her hair knotted in these little tiny fairy knots. You know, it was literally like strands of her hair were this...
knotted together?
And knotted together.
Wow.
and a whole little, like a whole inch patch behind her ear. It was crazy stuff that happened when I was using the fairy oracle. One time my husband was on his way home, and my daughter Lilla was about 3.5-4 years old, and he thought he saw her dancing in the window, because me and my mom were in this like little nook area that we had in our apartment where we had the computer set up, and we were karaokeing. And you know, the kids are in bed, and me and my mom are in the kitchen, and he sees this like little girl, what it looks like a little child, little girl, dancing in front of the window, and he comes up and he looks in both bedrooms, and both the girls are asleep. And he comes in, he's like, I just saw something. He's like, I don't know what it is, what it was. He's like, did Lilla just go to bed? And I was like, no, she's been asleep. And he's like, I just saw, he's like, I saw something dancing in the window.
Wow.
I had blonde hair and was small enough to see the whole body in the window. At mm-hmm. the time, you know, he just thought of our oldest daughter because she has blonde hair and blue eyes. But then the more he thought about it, he's like, no, it was like she was standing on the windowsill itself. It could have been, it was too small to be Lilla when he really thought about it.
Wow.
That's one crazy.
No, I thought you had one where there was something under a dresser or something at some point.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. But
this was like a little gremlin type of looking thing.
Really?
It was, we were on the Ouija board and...
that's a bad way to start.
It wasn't a Ouija board. It was a spirit talking board. It was one of the round ones.
Oh, okay, okay.
Not that that's any different, but it was one of the round ones. And we were on a spirit talking board, and it says, look under your dresser. And so I did, and I couldn't really see anything, but I thought I saw something in the corner, you know, and you think, okay, it's going to be a sock or something like that. So I had my friend David go get the broom, and he come back with the broom. And we poked it, and it made the most unnatural screech you could imagine. And it ran up the wall and along the wall out my window because my Siamese cat had tore out the screens in the corner so she could get in and out of the house mm-hmm. at free will whenever she wanted.
Yeah.
And this thing went up across the wall and then out the corner of the window, and it was gone. But it looked like a fuzzy, it looked almost like a kitten, a demonic kitten, or a really fuzzy rat.
They don't climb up walls, though.
No. It made the most, the strangest sound you could ever imagine.
Huh. Crazy, crazy, crazy. Yeah, cats have absolutely no respect for for anything. Oh, you like the screen? No, I need a door. Okay, and I'm going to go to another article that actually also covers the dog people things. But this one wasn't in Ohio. It was in Kentucky. And they say in this that it's a possible sighting. So, you know, they're not trying to say that's, you know, definitely anything. But it says a woman and her son who live on a mountaintop in Breeding, Kentucky. Wow, what a name, Breeding, Kentucky. I have reported that what they described as a dogman werewolf bipedal canine type of creature. The woman said that the possible cryptid had been heard howling in close vicinity to their property, and that one night the thing banged on the side of her house. They shot at the creature, but no blood or prints were found. They also report that they have found evidence of something prowling around their land and still occasionally hear the howling now at a distance, and that case is still ongoing. That's interesting. So that's in Breeding, Kentucky. Breeding. Yeah. Kentucky has many canine-like related sightings. I know, right? And legends. There is a beast between the lakes, a wolfman that roams western Kentucky. There are others, including an interesting account from Bath County, Kentucky. People who have seen the Barilla say that it's a beast with wolf-like features. It sounds like something that would only be in fairy tales, but some researchers say people have seen the creature and even been attacked by it for decades in Kentucky. In Lexington, 1800s, Courtney Fisher goes in search of evidence of its existence, okay? Kentucky backwoods keeps quite a few secrets, secrets that if you're lucky will reveal themselves, but some, no matter how patient you are, stay hidden. Barrella lurks in the woods, so experts say, with the last known sighting occurring in 1989. Yeah, it's the year I graduated. I just dated myself. The broad-shouldered beast has the body of a bear and a long, pointed muzzle like a wolf. It has hands with dagger-like claws and canine teeth. It's allegedly been seen through parts of Kentucky, Wisconsin, Michigan, Canada, and Pennsylvania, with dozens of sightings reported. Of course, the first case in the 1940s said the researcher Ron Coffey, a young boy claimed to be attacked on a creek bank by the creature. I do not discount that many eyewitnesses, everybody just not imagining things and making it up. Coffey had not found any bones or remains, but says that he can prove that Barilla exists. They have a plaster cast of a footprint. Coffey says he found the tracks last winter in Bath County and matches the description of a Barilla's foot. This is like, why do they call it a Barilla? It doesn't look like a bear and a gorilla. It looks like a wolf, but I don't know. I don't know why they call it Barilla. That's one of those mysteries we may never understand.
Well, why are they calling it Dogman and not Werewolf?
Yeah, another thing, I'll bet you it's just because werewolf has that kind of stigmata to it, that, you know, a stigma to it that, you know, it's like vampires and werewolves. It's like, okay, we're not going to believe in it. I don't know how they think Dogman makes it any more believable. but maybe, well, giving it a new name gives it more credibility.
Are we still talking about a shape-shifting person who's shape-shifting into this animal, and that's why we don't detect it?
Well,
or is this an actual creature out in the wild that is very, very good at not being seen, detected by anything, even Fleur? You know,
That's a good point. A very good point. That's possible. But yeah, a werewolf would definitely indicate a person that shifts into a wolf. And they're not necessarily saying that they've seen anything human-like there. So maybe that's why they're calling it a dogman or a bearilla, is because it's actually like maybe an unknown creature and not like a human creature combo. Maybe.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's see, back to the story. Coffey may have been researching Barilla for more than 2 decades, but there's another person who's had his eyes on the woods for just as long, and he lives right across the street. Says, I think somebody's trying to start a good hoax, says skeptic John Pugh. With a laugh, that's my opinion. Pugh says he has his own proof there's no Barilla. His roosters and his chickens that roam his yard and have never been attacked by a monster beast. At nighttime, it's always peaceful and quiet, he said. You don't hear anything going on. That's enough for him to know that no 7-foot wolf-like creature is lurking in the woods across the way. He says he'll believe it when he sees it. It could be a hoax. It could be people looking for money off telling their story. Who knows? But Coffey said that it's only a matter of time until another clue surfaces or another eyewitness comes forward proving that Barilla exists. That's interesting. So Barilla in Kentucky.
Or by the sound of the first people, it will just be dead on someone's porch.
Could be. I mean, if they shot it, they didn't find the blood, but who knows? Maybe they hit it. Maybe it's dead.
But if that's,
they said they still heard howling. So I don't know. That's
true. People can howl too.
People can howl too. That's right. My daughter howls really well. I'm sure you could howl really well.
Exactly, and then I could bang on someone's door and
get chased very true.
Away by the.
So I think they need more than a footprint, because a footprint could be created.
I mean, what about Silver Creek? There was like, it didn't sound like any trace evidence or even
no.
The
no.
sound you what you suggested was they decided to go back 3 months later or something. And have
it was quite a long time later. Yeah. And then, I mean, how do you find evidence that much time passes? I mean, there's all kind of wildlife that goes through areas, and they should have gone back immediately. But then again, maybe the guy wasn't comfortable with it. I don't know. Was scared, didn't tell anybody until later on. I don't know if he told him right away. Hard to say.
Yeah, I guess not. It's probably always going to be in vain, though, if you leave it that late. I'm not saying it's a fault, it's a problem that he did, but yeah, I mean, you can't expect to find much after that amount of time.
Right.
All I was going to add to that is, like, mm-hmm. I think I have a personal rule, like, if I won't allow a sighting to register, well, not register, I just won't deal with one unless it's like at least 5 or 10 seconds long in any instance, because God damn, if I want to spend my life worrying about something I thought I saw for one second in my life, it's like, that's too extreme for me.
Well, now there are some things that,
if something dashes across the way in front of you, you get 1 second chance. And if people want to dedicate their life there forward to trying to prove that something dashed across their windscreen, then fair enough. But that's extreme in my opinion.
We've actually had, we've had some of those dashing things, actually, not too long ago, actually. We've seen some very unusually shaped, dark, shadow-looking creatures in our upper part of our yard, because we're in a very wooded area, private community, but it's a very wooded area. And I've seen it. My kids have seen it. It's extremely fast. It's very large. Bigger than any of the deer, because we have lots of deer around here. So whenever I hear something, I always assume it's one of the deer or something. But this thing was very large, bigger than even a buck. Very fast.
But I'm interested to know is what you then, using that information, someone like yourself, Lenita, probably
I ignored it.
Can just live with it. Exactly.
But, I do. I did just live with it. I mean, I'd actually, that wasn't even something that I shared on ATS. It's just kind of one of those things that I'm just like, you know what? My son and I both saw the thing at the same time, and we both looked at each other. You just saw that, right? And it's like, we both basically put our hands up and said, don't want to know right now. Just don't want to know. Don't want to think about it. Don't want to know. There comes a point when you deal with so many unusual, anomalous things that you have to pick and choose which things you actually want to know more about. And we got to that point with that. And this was like literally just a few weeks ago that we saw this thing. It was very large and very fast. And we just put up our hands and we're like, we don't want to know. It didn't look like it was an actual animal. It looked like a shadow animal. Which we're so used to shadow beings that, you know, it was just like, forget it, you know.
Well, that's cool. I'm just trying to understand why then, let's say next week, it mm-hmm. doesn't just go past, it actually comes and bangs on your door.
Well,
do
no,
you
if
then,
it did
do you
that,
then get a gun and go and shoot it? Is that?
I don't think you would be able to with something like what we saw. I don't think bullets would affect it. I would endeavor to probably use spiritual or energetic techniques to try to get rid of it, because the type of thing that we saw didn't look physical. It looked like, okay, I don't know if you've ever seen a shadow being, Mark. Oftentimes people will see them out the corner of their eye, but it's not like a normal shadow, because it actually has like dimension to it. And some of them actually look like they have mass, like it's a massive shadow, like a blob of shadow almost, because they present themselves in lots of different ways. So I don't know if you've actually seen one, because you mentioned, you know, you have to see something for more than a few seconds. Obviously, you've seen one or two things. Have you ever seen a shadow out of the corner of your eye that vanished when you turned to look at it full on?
Maybe. I don't do the whole I turn and I see something. There was a time when I tried out, I guess, some not Ouija board, but, you know, things along those lines.
I think
I think around that time I did see things that I would justify as seeing them, not turning around and it disappearing.
Right.
But actual solid state stuff, as you say. But as I said it just now into chat to you, if that thing is just chasing deer, why then is it automatically an evil being? I mean, that sounds like
I don't think
just...
it is, not necessarily.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't feel one way or the other about it. That's why I kind of at the moment, I mean, if I felt like a real threat there, I probably wouldn't have just thrown up my hands and said, I don't want to know, you know. If I felt that there was actually a threat to my family, I would have, you know, considered other options. But I didn't feel like that. I didn't get that feeling. And I can almost always intuit and feel almost that negative energy off of a being when it's actually malicious in its intent towards, you know, the people it's appearing to.
So could that mean it's probably not or probably could be related to like Silver Creek and breeding?
I don't know, because I mean they're talking about these things like they're more physical. So I don't think it's along the same lines as theirs. I think it's just another cryptoid type of thing. And I don't even know if it would fall into that, because like I said, it seemed more like shadow, which I don't know. Those shadow things, they're more dimensional, I think, or something of that nature.
Yeah, but the dogmen and that sort of thing, everyone.
Yeah, those are kind
of really
physical. Yeah. I mean, I don't even know that they should be scared of them. They were chasing deer, not humans, but.
That's the bit I just can't get my head around. It's like,
yeah.
I think people
are automatically afraid of things that they don't understand. And I think that's just the very simplest form of that. And why, you know, people make such a big deal out of things like that is because I think there's just this innate fear of things that are unknown, things that we don't understand. It's, I guess, part of the human genetic code, probably, for most people.
Yeah, but now when I saw with my cousins, when we saw our dog man, we were just terrified just because it was...
Because it was something unfamiliar.
Yeah, and it was big. Mm-hmm. Bigger than us. You know, we were kids.
And it was 12. A total unknown. I mean, I think there's a natural human instinct to protect.
Yeah.
Survival instinct.
Flee, fight, you know, fight.
Fight or flee, something like that.
Yeah, fight or flee, and we fled.
I think that was the right choice.
Screaming like banshees into the night.
I think that was definitely the right choice, the right path to go, honestly, especially as children.
But do I think that it was evil? No, I didn't get that sense. It didn't have glowing red eyes or anything.
Right.
It didn't.
And who's to say that glowing red eyes means that something's evil? I mean, that's kind of been something that, you know, people take
right.
granted now. But, you know, there are animals with red eyes that aren't evil. You know, I think that's something that's been conditioned into us societally through films and, you know, pop culture and things like that, that we have a certain set of criteria that instantly instills fear in people, which is kind of sad to a certain extent, because it prevents us from understanding and seeking truth more, going beyond the fear and pushing into understanding and approaching. Perhaps, maybe it would be foolish, but you won't know if you don't try. So sometimes you have to make that effort to face things that you don't understand head on, because it's not going to make them not exist just because, well, it might make them not exist if you don't pay attention to them. In some cases, I think some things can manifest when there's a focus on them. Some things can also disappear. I think that is a lot to do with, we did a show about fairies, and I think some things can come closer into our veil of being when there is a lot of energy focused on a belief in them. And I think that was from a time when people actually believed in magic, in the true sense of magic. In a time when the world actually embraced natural magic that exists in the world. And nowadays, people think magic is just something that's fake. It's a part of mythology. But magic is something that has always been a part of our universe, a part of our world. And at some points in time, it's been embraced. And, you know, we're going back kind of to hour one. If you think about the way that the law of attraction works, it could be considered magic. For for people who don't understand it and don't understand how and why they're making things happen that they want to happen. And I think some forms, I think the reason that magical practice and witchcraft, Wicca, I think the reason it works is because it is a way of focusing your manifesting creative energies on a single thing to help it come into being. So it's, I don't know that all of the ritual is really necessary, but it helps people focus on what they want, which helps create it more easily. It helps them make sure that the manifestation actually occurs because there is so much focus on a single thing, a single goal, a single desire.
But where that is popularized, it's also blown out of proportion. I don't disagree, but take Harry Potter or something, instantly they can manifest something. And that's probably a viewpoint.
That's not realistic, but that's also part of what helps keep it perceived as something that's unrealistic and unreal, because it's presented in a way that seems just ridiculous, you know?
Yep. There's magic to be found. Coincidence, these sort of things, that's little bits of maybe the universal magic.
I think so. I think coincidence is kind of, I think it's a little bit magical when you think about it, when you think about all the little things that have to come together for these little coincidences to fall into place.
Yeah, that's like the things of stardust, mm-hmm. that sort of stuff.
Yep. I think the concept of religion has replaced the concept of magic. I think that's kind of what happened. I think that's why it's gone by the wayside. It's still the same thing, though. I mean, it doesn't matter what name you put into your creative force that you have, that divine spark within you, that ability to manifest your reality, it doesn't matter how you view it. It doesn't matter how you make it happen. It's still the same thing. You're still using the same thing. You may not even know that you're using it. You might not be aware of it, but it's still happening and still being done. That's one of the things that I think it's really important that people understand, because it will help them be more mindful about what they bring into their life when they realize that they're solely creating their reality. I mean, in conjunction with other people, because everybody has their own visions of their future that they want to see. So it's a combination of an enormous amount of people all envisioning their futures that decide what our reality is. So if we can focus more on our positive realities instead of the negative realities, when would you want to see something no longer exist in your reality? Instead of focusing on that thing, what you need to focus on is what the alternative to that thing is. That way, that thing will naturally go by the wayside, and you're bringing in, instead, you're drawing on the positive energies to create a new, more positive reality for the future. And you're helping the world as a whole overall manifest into a more positive reality by your energies. And if more people do that, the combined energies will help us live in a better world. If we think we can heal the planet, we can heal the planet. It can be done. Because we're living in a time right now where we're really at a critical hour. Mother Earth, she's hurt. I mean, it's like she has cancer. You know, we are an infection of cancer on her right now. What we need to be is a healing force instead of a disease. And we can do that. There are ways that we can do that. There are little things that we can do. There are actions that we can make. But also, by deciding what kind of a future we want, by looking towards a future and making choices about using clean energy instead of fossil fuels, taking steps to buy vehicles that don't consume oil and gas and things like that. Little things that we do, if we all do them, these little things add up and they make a difference and they start change. So we can make a change to the planet, even if we feel like we're only one person. But all of us are only one person, but we're all connected. So we all work together to manifest our world and our reality. And our numbers are greater than the numbers of those that are in power by a lot. So if we stop giving in to the negative media culture that makes us try to focus and worry about all the bad and all the evil in the world and all the hate and all the pain and all the suffering. If we focus instead about how we can change that and do better things, this whole world will turn around. We're already seeing so much change in the world. It's already happening. It's already happening. And there's actually something I wanted to bring up. RandomActsOfKindness.org has a little contest going on called Be the Spark. And they're having this to where you share a story of your act of kindness. And they're collecting all of these stories together, and they're going to put them into a video. And they're partnering up with the Kind World Series from WBUR, Boston's NPR news station. And so this is a contest, and then I guess they will turn the winning entry into a beautiful audio story to share with the world on NPR. And so the deadline for this is July 15th. But if, you know, any of our listeners out there have either done an act of kindness that they'd like to share with the world, or perhaps they've been on the receiving end of an act of kindness and they want to share it, you should go to www.randomactsofkindness.org /kind and then a -world-contest. And, enter your story there and share it and be inspiring to the world. Yeah. we're getting close to the end of the show. We have 5 minutes left. And I guess we've kind of gone, I went way away from our main topic, haven't I, guys? I went way off topic.
That's cool. I think we... kind of figured out that Silver Creek, well, I've just been checking Silver Creek, according to Vladimir Putin, it's actually the Queen of England that's shape-shifting around Silver Creek, so don't worry, that's been explained.
That's all solved now. Okay, that's just a matter of fact. We need to all just accept that as part of our reality.
We do. Yeah. It's just Barilla. Now we need to solve.
I've seen pictures of the Queen, and she, when she was younger, she looked quite lovely and gentle. I've also seen pictures of her now, and some of them aren't so flattering, but I've also seen pictures of Beyonce that looked like she was possessed. If you take a photo of a person at the wrong time, it can make them look a certain way. So I certainly am not judging the Queen.
Totally. Well, no, yeah. I don't think... You strayed from the subject, really. We covered a lot, didn't we? Duality.
We've covered an awful lot, yeah. I think for the last little bit, I could throw in my final crypto story, I guess, as it is. This happened probably 6 or 7 years ago, and it was a couple of years after the whole weird Sasquatchy Bigfoot-looking sighting thing that happened. This was actually something that happened that actually sparked my my journey, my shamanic journey, and brought me back to the path. Because there had been a great deal of time between when I was told I was a shaman at the age of 16 and when I actually started mindfully accepting that and walking the path. And this was one of the things that actually was the catalyst for that. So I was coming back to my house, and I was still kind of out in the country from grabbing some groceries, and I was driving down kind of a backcountry road, and from the side, this enormous bird just rises up directly in front of me. I don't know where it came from. I really don't. But the sheer size of this thing, I had to slow down because I was afraid I was going to hit it because it was taking a real long time to get into the air. And it, as it's in front of me, I don't even know how, I don't understand how I didn't hit it. I had to slow way down. But this bird, its wingspan was so big. We were we had a Suburban, which is a, you know, a SUV, and its wingspan was so large that you couldn't see all of it in the windshield. You could actually, the body of the bird wasn't even all in the windshield. It was like completely obscuring my view, but it looked like an enormous raven. It looked exactly like a raven, but I couldn't tell because I couldn't see the head, but it was black. It had the curvature to the bottom of the bottom of the tail feathers, and the wings were black. But I couldn't see its head because it was that large. I couldn't see its head in the windshield. It was too big to see the head of it. But it gets up in the air finally, and I'm just like reeling, wondering what I just saw. So I get home, and guess where I went, Mark?
Don't
guess
know.
Where I went? ATS.
Oh, right. And you told the whole world.
Of course I did. Well, I asked. And then I started doing some research, and I found information about Thunderbirds. It was the only thing that really fit in. And I found some images of what were said to be Thunderbirds. And some, you know, some were called hoaxes and here and there. But here's the thing. Over the ages, there are some hoaxes that I think are government disinfo trying to, you know, make people not believe in something. But what I found out after I found out this was a Thunderbird was that Thunderbird is actually one of the primary symbols of my tribe and my nation. I am Ho-Chunk, formerly known as Winnebago, but that is my tribe as a Native American. And when I looked this up, I realized that this was a symbol of my tribe. And then people started telling me, you know, this is a sign, go back to your roots, you know, look back into your past. Well, there was a lot about my past that was really unknown. My father was adopted. And so my grandfather is an unknown. I have no idea who he is. I do know who my grandmother is, but I have no idea who his father was. And so I started going back to the tribe, and then that's when a whole lot of paranormal activity started to happen after sighting this bird. And we actually saw this bird a couple more times over the next few weeks, and the kids saw it, and they... This thing was so large that they were afraid it was going to carry away our dog because we had a little dachshund. So he's a little wiener dog. They were scared to death that this bird was going to kidnap and fly away with our dog. So
that's cool. Yeah. I agree. There are probably visual indicators out there. Mm. That's a very intense one, definitely.
That was the ancestors reaching out to me and calling me back to the path. And I started walking it from there. And here we are today. And you know, this is part of my journey, this show, you know, so, yeah. That is it for this week. We are getting ready to be interrupted by music, so I want to thank all of our listeners for joining us, and I want to thank Mark and Melina for being here with me. Our guest, I will hopefully reschedule with, and we will have Michael Perlin at a date in the future when he's not really busy. If you guys want to stop on our Facebook page and give us a like, that would be awesome. It is facebook.com/anomalousrealities. And also on Twitter, my Twitter is at Nita Who. That's NITAWHO. I've changed it. So, yeah. Everybody have a wonderful weekend, and thank you for tuning in. Good night.
Night.
Bye.